Now, here at the Naval Academy, we have you doing all kinds of silly stuff. We have you put your paw out instead of raise your hand. We make you walk funny. We even change the way you speak. We have you memorize all kinds of silly stuff. Memorize a menu. That's pretty silly. But I'm here to tell you people that out in the fleet, if you don't pay attention to the silly stuff, you'll die. Now let me introduce you to some of the bodies I have known. A pilot was trying to land his crippled aircraft. Suddenly it started going dangerously out of control, and we knew there was no way he was going to be able to safely land that aircraft. So we knew the only other option was for him to eject. Now, all you have to do to activate an ejection seat, reach up over your head, pull a face curtain one time. Canopy pops off, rockets go out from underneath the seat, and you just get shot out, and then you float down safely in your little parachute. So we sat there over and over again. I stood there with the crash crew, and we repeated like a litany, a prayer. Come on, man, punch out, punch out. Now, you can only go so low in altitude and still safely eject. And he was rapidly approaching that too low altitude. Come on, man, punch out, punch out. I had a motion picture camera. I zoomed into the cockpit. I could see that man's face. I watched him pull on that face curtain over and over again in a desperate attempt to activate that ejection seat. But nothing happened. He was trapped. I watched that pilot die. I filmed his death. I watched that plane hit the ground nose first, flip end over end, break in two, and burst into two fireballs. I watched the frustration on the faces of the guys in crash crew as they raced out to those two fireballs and tried to guess which one was the cockpit so that maybe they could save that guy. But already it was too late. A later investigation of that accident revealed that just that morning, a 19-year-old sailor had worked on that on the ejection seat. A little tiny cotter pin, cost about 50 cents, about that big. This is not a high-tech piece of equipment. You got a 50-50 chance of putting it in there right or wrong. He guessed, and he put it in there backwards, and it rendered that entire ejection seat inoperable. Cause of that pilot's death, failure to pay attention to detail. I am convinced, after 25 years in the Navy and numerous dead bodies, that that's what should be listed on their death certificate. Cause of death, failure to pay attention to detail. Breakdown in teamwork. It's like inflating aircraft tires. The Navy knows how dangerous that job is. So it designed and built a big metal cage. And you roll that tire inside the cage, you lock it up, then you inflate it from the outside. Then if anything goes wrong, that tire is contained. But this young 19-year-old sailor decided, that's silly stuff. That takes too long. Roll the tire in, lock it up, roll the tire out, roll the tire in. So he decided to skip the silly stuff. He figured if he skipped that step, he could inflate more aircraft tires than anybody else in a given morning. And you know what? He was absolutely right. And he went to lunch that day feeling real proud of himself because he had, in fact, inflated more tires than anybody else. He came back from lunch still feeling real proud of himself. Then he died. The very next tire he inflated blew up. So the squadron called, photo lab, needing duty photographer, got a fatality. Now, standard operating procedure, whenever you shoot a fatality scene, you photograph 360 degrees around that room and perfectly preserve photographically every piece of evidence, every detail, so that even after the mess is cleaned up, the investigating officer has those 8x10 color photos to refer to for their investigation. I spent about an hour inside that room. Shot every square inch of it. But I knew my job wasn't done until I photographed the body. So I went out and asked the guys, they already taken the body to the hospital? And they said, no, he's in there. I said, come on, guys, you're pulling my leg. I just spent an hour in that room, and I didn't step over any dead body. And they said, go look again. I went back in that room, and the first piece of evidence I found was a metal belt buckle, just like the one I wear. That metal belt buckle was embedded in a brick bulkhead. It was twisted and mangled almost beyond recognition, and it survived better than his body did. I'm here to tell you, people, they couldn't pull him down off those bricks. They had to scrape him and hose him off the wall. Cause of death? Failure to pay attention to detail. That's what your detailers are trying to teach you. That's the importance of paying attention to detail. Because if you don't, you'll pay the supreme price. And when I first came in the Navy, I went all over the base all day long. Duty drivers come pick me up in different vehicles, take me out to job sites. And on every dashboard was stenciled this sign in big red letters. It said, look before backing. I don't know about you, but I thought that's a pretty stupid sign. How many of you people knew before you came to the Naval Academy to look before backing? Every one of you, right? What, are you from New York and don't drive? That's what I figured. If you're a licensed driver, you should already know to look before backing. You shouldn't need this stupid sign out here saying, look before backing. I finally concluded that the Navy had an excess of red paint and a young airman that didn't have a job, so they gave him the red paint and said, here, it's your job to go around and mess up all these dashboards with this stupid sign. Look before backing. Hospital call. Need a duty photographer. Got a fatality victim. I was second-class petty officer by then, and I was real good at shooting dead bodies. I was so good at it that I could walk in that morgue and look at that body, and I could tell you instantly whether that was a dead helo pilot or a dead jet jockey. You see, when helos go down, the engine lands in the pilot's lap. I have seen a little tiny wing nut pierce a man's leg and split it in part like a grizzly bear tore it in two. Just a little wing nut, just a little silly stuff. However, if that body laying up there is a crispy critter, that's a jet jockey, because they crash and burn. I knew too well the sounds, the smell in that familiar room. It's got a big stainless steel table in the middle of the room, water trickling down the side. That washes away the blood and guts while they do the autopsy. It's very quiet in that room. It's very cold. So I walked in that room, braced against the sights and the smells, and I looked up on the table, and it was empty. So I looked at the corpsman, and I said, didn't they bring the body yet? And the corpsman said, yeah, she's here. And he pointed to a spot on the deck. Now, the fact that that body was on the deck was not the reason I didn't see it when I first went in there. The real reason I didn't see that body was because she was so little. She was so very tiny that all it took to cover her little body was a little tiny green dish towel. And I'm here to tell you something. I'm 44 years old, and I don't care how old I get, and if I get Alzheimer's disease, I will never, ever forget that little tiny green dish towel. Two little tiny sneakers poked out the end of that dish towel. I looked down at those sneakers and I saw that the toes were scuffed. And I remember looking at those thinking, you know, she probably scuffed them dragging them behind her tricycle because she was just about the age that you start riding a trike. She was only 3 years old. Out either side of that dish towel poked two little tiny hands. Hands so new to life, they didn't even have knuckles. That little sweet dimples, where one day knuckles would have grown if only some sailor had looked before backing. It was a 19-year-old sailor's job to drive the shuttle bus from the main side into the, from the base housing and transport the dependents into medical appointments, shopping at the exchange, whatever. He didn't look before backing, and he crushed that baby's head beneath the rear wheels of that bus. I'm here to tell you, even after 25 years, that is the hardest job I ever had to shoot. It also is the fastest job I ever shot. I fired that last frame, and I bolted out of that room. And I ran down the passageways of that hospital. And I didn't run because I was going to be sick. I ran because I knew I was going to cry, and I didn't want the corpsman to see me cry. But I'll tell you this for nothing, I didn't run fast enough. Not before I went out those double glass doors and saw a woman coming in the other side of those same double glass doors. A woman who required no introduction. I knew immediately from her anguished cries who she was. Please, God, no, no, don't let my baby be dead, no. And I was glad that young mother didn't know what I was there to photograph. Cause of that baby's death? Failure to pay attention to detail. Now turn and face each other. Do it. Turn and face each other. Each other. I don't care if there's three of you looking together. Just look at somebody. I want you to look at this person, and when you go out in a fleet and you have your head up your butt and you make the wrong decision, you ignore the safety precaution, this may be who you kill. And I want you to know right now that this is not just some plebe, some fourth-class midshipman with an alpha number. This is somebody's baby. This is somebody's son. This is somebody's daughter. He's the big brother that taught the little brother how to dribble a basketball. She's the favorite grandchild of that little sweet grandma. And I think when you kill this person, you should have to escort the body home. You stand there at parade rest at the head of that casket in your dress uniform. I've been there. I'll tell you what it's like. You stand up there and you watch each member of this family grieve for the loss of this child. The first person to come up to that flag-draped coffin will be the mother. Her steps will be halting and slow. It's a long walk up there. When she finally does reach that coffin, she will hurl herself across it, arms outstretched, in a last desperate attempt to hug this child goodbye forever. The father will come next. Watch his big, broad shoulders. He who has probably never cried in public. Watch those same broad shoulders when he reaches the casket. And those shoulders will heave in uncontrollable sobs of grief as he looks down and knows that every dream, every wish, every hope he had for this child now lies dead in a casket. Then you offer your lame excuses. Then you look at that grieving family and say, oops, I'm sorry. Oh, I thought I checked. Oh, I forgot. Your lame excuses will not dry one tear. You will live with that the rest of your life. And that is a worse punishment than anything we can think of here at the Naval Academy. Now turn and face the center. Do it. There are two types of body bags out in the fleet. This is one type. You notice on one side it has a blue polyethylene absorbent shield. This absorbs the blood and guts. You also notice I am 5'2", and this bag is not big enough to hold my entire body. That's because this bag is not designed for entire bodies. This is for the parts and the pieces. When a pilot crashed and was strewn for 3 miles up Pensacola Beach, and a crab had a piece of that pilot clutched in its claw, I chased that crab. I wrestled that piece of my shipmate away from it, photographed it, and gave it to the corpsman to sack up in a bag like this. This, people, is a trash bag for human beings. This is where oops, I'm sorry ends up. This is where, oh, I forgot to check ends up. This is the final resting place of your mistakes. Miss Kaczynski, you're dead. Lay down on my body bag. This is the other type of body bag. Big green body bag. Has handles on either side for easy carrying. Zipper up the middle. One size fits all. Lots of these came back from Vietnam. Mr. Staver, you're dead. Lay down on my body bag. Do it. How old are you?
17
years old. How old are you?
18.
Teenagers. 17, 18. That is too young to be dead. I got socks older than that. They should have a long, fruitful life, but it has been cut short by somebody else's mistake, by a failure to pay attention to detail, by a breakdown in teamwork. You want to escort them home? You want to write the letters to their mom? You want to live with this on your memory the rest of your life? Then you better learn here, while the price is cheap, to pay attention to detail, to take care of your shipmates, to make the right decisions. I hereby resurrect you two. Get up. See how powerful master chiefs are in the Navy that can let you live again. Fold up my body bags. Put them right over there. It's the only time you'll get a second chance at life. Now, during Vietnam, there was a POW named Captain Stratton. One day, he got a roommate. His roommate came in the cell, properly introduced himself. He said, "Hi, my name's Doug, and I can say the Gettysburg Address backwards." The captain looked at him and said, "Well, you know, here we are in the middle of a combat zone. We're prisoners. Don't know if we're going to survive this or not. You want me to be impressed with the fact you can say the Gettysburg Address backwards? I don't think so." Even the VC figured Big Dumb Doug was too stupid to know anything. They interrogated him one time and said, "Nah." Gave him a broom, put him out in the courtyard, and had him sweep dirt. Now, every time a billowed-out parachute appeared on the horizon, the VC knew that meant another downed American pilot. So they would jump in their trucks, and they'd run right out there, and by the time that pilot's boots hit the deck, he was immediately surrounded by the enemy, captured, doomed to the existence for years and the agony of being a prisoner of war. But this day, the VC ran out, jumped in their truck, and it didn't start. And because of that precious moment's delay, that pilot's boots hit the deck. He cut his shroud lines from his parachute, and he escaped back into friendly territory. Did not have to suffer the anguish of being a POW for years to come. That scene was played out more than once. But the VC didn't catch on because they had already stereotyped Big Dumb Doug, so they didn't suspect him. But Captain Stratton knew. He knew that Big Dumb Doug was the only other person that had access to the sky. So every time he saw a billowed-out parachute, he would take his little broom and he'd sweep up some dirt and he'd get a handful and he'd go over to the truck and he'd shove it in the gas tank. That's why the truck didn't start. And the captain watched this play out more than once and said, "You know, the Navy gave me college education, multi-million dollar aircraft, all kinds of armament. How many enemy trucks do I have? None. Here's this guy armed with a high school diploma and a broom. How many enemy trucks does he have? Five. He was one of only two POWs that, while a prisoner of war, was able to disable enemy property." Then Big Dumb Doug went to the VC and said, "You know, if y'all get me some glasses, because I lost mine when I got blown overboard, I'll read some of your communist books and maybe I'll be one of y'all." So they thought, "Oh, hallelujah, we got our first American convert." So they broke their neck to run right out and get him those glasses. The truth was, Big Dumb Doug had never worn glasses a day in his life. He put those glasses on, and when he swept past your cage, he'd say, "When I touch my glasses like that, that's an A. Hand in the middle of my glasses would be, put my glasses on top of my head, that's a C." He came up with an entire communication system based on those glasses. Now, when you knew your buddy had the hell beat out of him, you could send a simple message by Big Dumb Doug. "Hey, man, go tell my buddy I'm praying for him. And maybe, just maybe, That simple message was enough to give that POW the will to live another day. Maybe that simple message was enough to give that POW the stamina to withstand one more torture session. Now, the pressure was on back in the United States, send our boys back home. So the VC figured out, well, Big Dumb Doug would make a good token release. You see, he's not as scarred and maimed as those we tortured. So they offered him a freedom flight home. He declined. So somebody else went. A second time, they offered him a freedom flight home. Again, he declined, and again, someone else went home. And a third time. Now, he had to be as scared and as homesick as anybody else there. But he knew how much his shipmates depended on him. He knew he was the hub of communication. He knew escape plans could be made now because they had communication. A fourth time, they offered him a freedom flight home, and a fourth time, he declined. On a fifth time, he became the only American U.S. sailor to be kicked out of Vietnam. They said, just screw it, Doug, get on the plane and go home. So he did. This is the part that always gives me goosebumps. The same kid whose one claim to fame was his little silly ability to say the Gettysburg Address backwards, stood in front of a U.S. Senate committee and recited a perfectly memorized list of over 386 names, rank, service number, branch of service, place of captivity. Just silly stuff. But not to those families. To those families, that was the first piece of hope they had, first shred of evidence to know that their husband, their father, their son was alive. Big Dumb Doug was 19 years old and a seaman apprentice. This book is a collection of Medal of Honor citations. I think it's fitting to read one of those here in Memorial Hall. I'm going to read to you the shortest citation in here. It's only 5 lines long, and it reads as follows. It's for a young man named James Richard Ward, who also was 19 years old, and a seaman, an E3. The entire citation reads as follows. For conspicuous devotion to duty, extraordinary courage, and complete disregard of his own life, above and beyond the call of duty, during the attack on the fleet in Pearl Harbor by Japanese forces on 7 December 1941. When it was seen that the USS Oklahoma was going to capsize and the order was given to abandon ship, Seaman Ward remained in a turret, holding a flashlight so the remainder of the turret crew could see to escape, thereby sacrificing his own life. Ship. Shipmate. Self. Just little silly stuff. Just a little silly flashlight. Ship. Shipmate. Self. He so believed in that, that he died for it. That's what it's all about, people. That's why we're all here. Ship. Shipmate. Self. To close up that end right there. Castle, come here. Mr. Day, come here. Back up a little. Close enough to all these people that they can reach out and touch this. Reach out and touch the red stripe that stands for the blood of another 19-year-old. He went from the senior prom to Vietnam. He wasn't old enough to vote for the president who sent him there. He was not old enough to even buy a beer before he left. But his blood was not too young to spill in the jungles of Vietnam for the name of that flag, this country, this democracy, and the freedom that that flag stands for. That is a universal symbol throughout the world of freedom. There are people who have dug tunnels underneath walls to escape to that kind of freedom. Walls that have fallen during your lifetime. Today in Cuba, there are families who will secretly gather together little scraps of wood and pieces of plastic, and they'll nail that stuff together, and they'll put their entire family on it, and they'll shove off from the shores of Cuba, pray to God and hope to hell that they reach this country, the United States of America, and its freedom. There are women who in the 9th month of pregnancy swim the Rio Grande to reach the other side, to reach the soil of Texas, so that that baby can be born in America, so that that baby can be blessed with the same birthright every one of you are blessed with, to be an American. Oh, God, how precious. Think about it. The freedom you have experienced all of your life because you are an American. Think what a precious freedom that is. Think how many other people under oppression don't have that. And you've had it all of your life. This is what it's all about, people. Many of you had scholarships, 4 years, a free ride to another university, and you turned them down. You chose to come here because you didn't want the free ride. You wanted more. You wanted a challenge. Well, you've got it now. You stand here ready to be future United States Naval officers, future United States Marine Corps officers. And I will tell you this, that when the Marines trudged through the blood, through the mud and left the trail of blood, it was that flag that covered their coffins and their broken bodies and the last vestige of honor that this country can offer its fallen heroes. That's who you stand behind, that's who you shall follow. But you have the courage, the honor, and the commitment to do that. I've watched you on I-Day. I've watched your families. I watched you as you stood out there and said goodbye to everybody you loved. So many of you had your moms and dads. Some of you had grandparents. I saw little brothers and sisters running around there, looking up at that big brother saying, I'm going to miss you. And I watched you as you did your about face, turned your back on your family, and proudly and determinedly walked into Bancroft Hall. And then I watched your mother. See, the last words she said to you when she hugged you goodbye, I love you, baby. You be sure and write to me. And your dad hugged you in that big familiar bear hug, and he slapped you on the back, and he said, I'm proud of you, son. And you let go of all that. You sacrificed all that. You left everything you love and everything familiar to you to come here and do this. I have trained thousands of recruits in 2 tours as a company commander. I have trained hundreds of photographers' mates when I was on instructor duty. Those recruits that I first trained in 1977 are now chief petty officers, and they now train a second generation of sailors. I am the grandmother of the Navy. This is my Navy family you have joined. I have loved every sailor I have raised in the Navy, and I will not allow you to go out into the fleet and make a mistake, a bad decision, and kill one of my troops. Think about that. In November, I will retire from the Navy. And I hand over to you my legacy, my Navy family, for you to go out there and lead it. Generations of sailors. They continue on because we all take care of each other. When you go out there in a fleet as a Navy officer, a Marine Corps officer, I will not accept mediocrity. told me that because that's what you're supposed to say. But now you have to make it happen. And it happens day by day. Little pieces of progress here and there until you build what your reputation is. Till you build the best. Till you become the best. That's what you're here for. And you're not going to make it through here by yourself. Nobody gets through it alone. There is a big dumb dog in this company that shines shoes better than anybody else in this company. And that kid will get this entire company through a PI inspection. But that same kid is going to buckle when it comes to a chemistry exam. And one of you other kids with a 9-digit IQ is going to take Big Dumb Doug, and you're going to study with him all night long until he passes that next test. And the two of you have made it together. Team. T-E-A-M. Together, everyone accomplishes more. That's what it's about. Are you a team?
Yes,
yes, yes. Do I have your promise to be the best?
Yes, yes, yes.
You have that kind of gravel in your guts and spit in your eye to be the best.
Yes, yes, yes.
And I will hold you to your promise, and I will stand by and watch your progress. Don't let me down.
Stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American where at least I know I'm free, and I won't forget the men who died who gave that right to me, and I gladly defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American. There ain't no doubt.